Let me introduce today's speaker. Markus Henrich is from Stockholm, and he did his undergrad work at the Stuttgart, his PhD until 2004 at MPQ Garching in the group of in the Rempe group on cavity QED and the controlled generation of single photons in an atom cavity system. Went on to work from 2004 to 2007 as a postdoctoral researcher with Jürgen Eschner at ICFO in Spain on ion-photon interaction. Since 2007 and until 2015, he's been at Innsbruck and has worked as an assistant and associate professor on quantum computation and quantum optics experiments. And since 2015, he's been an associate professor at Stockholm, where he's the group leader on trapped ion quantum technologies. In 2011, he received an ESC starting grant on a trapped ion Rydberg experiment. He's a chair of the cost action typical trapped ions progress in classical and quantum applications, and is also a co-PI of the Wallenberg Center for Quantum Technologies, which is a 12-year, around about 100 million euros grant to support quantum technology in Sweden. We are very much looking forward to your talk today on fast quantum operations with trapped Rydberg ions. The audience is yours.
Thank you very much, Christian.
Sorry if I interrupt you again. As usual for the audience, you may use the chat window if you discover any issues, or in the end, you may ask your questions using the Q&A window, but I'll say more about that later. Sorry.
Perfect. Okay, thank you very much for the kind introduction, Christian. And thank you very much for inviting me to give this beautiful seminar talk, or I hope it will be interesting for you. It's interesting to talk in front of something like five countries, many different institutions, five continents, many different institutions. It's quite a new experience for me. Okay, so what I will talk about today is fast quantum operations with trapped Rydberg ions. Basically, it's a summary of what we are doing in Stockholm, and what the main idea of this experiment is that we combine Rydberg physics and trapped ions. So fast quantum operations is something that we've achieved and published last year. And of course, first I will introduce the system and what this is actually good for, why we're actually doing that. So here an outline of my talk. So I will, since not everyone is familiar with trapped ion quantum computations, I will shortly introduce a quantum computer and how to do that with trapped ions. Also to actually relate that to this new approach of trapped Rydberg ions. What is actually new? Why do we do that? And why is it interesting to combine the Rydberg physics with these trapped ions? Then I will shortly describe the physics of these trapped Rydberg ions and quickly then describe what we've done on the fast trapped ion entanglement gates. So the main motivation for that is to do quantum computation. And of course, for doing quantum computation on atoms or ions, you need to encode qubits. And usually what is done in trapped ions is that you have different electronic states of these ions. And depending on which electronic state this ion resides, it can either encode a qubit state 0 or a qubit state 1. So it's, for instance, a ground state and an excited state of these ions that are used then for the qubit encoding. And by laser manipulation or microwave manipulation, you can then control this qubit state, drive transitions between these two states, and by that generate arbitrary superpositions of these two states. So a qubit, of course, cannot only be 0 and 1, but can also be superposition of 0 and 1, for instance, equal superposition 0 plus 1, 0 minus 1, or with arbitrary phase in between, but also with arbitrary amplitude in between these two. So by that, you can reach encode much more complex information than just with a bit that can only be 0 and 1. Here you have the full alpha and beta amplitudes of the qubit of the superposition alpha 0 plus beta 1. So yes, a qubit can be encoded in 0 and 1 at the same time. So for instance, the 0 plus 1 state is now a superposition, equal superposition of 0 plus 0 and 1. But as I said, a qubit can be encoded in arbitrary state psi with C00 plus C11. Of course, the full potential of a quantum computer only becomes visible if you go to many, many qubits. Then, of course, you have many, many more combinations of different qubit states from 000 plus 1111, and also any arbitrary combination of 0 and 1 of these qubits. And you have always amplitudes of these that contribute to the complex qubit state. So all of these amplitudes you need to know the superposition of a complex qubit state. If you want to do quantum calculations, what you then usually do is you apply a unitary transformation. Schrödinger equation, of course, defines that any time evolution due to Schrödinger equation is a unitary transformation. So a quantum calculation on a quantum computer usually consists of such a unitary transformation. And in order to do such a unitary transformation, you can decompose this unitary transformation in individual rotations and individual quantum operations. And what you actually need to do any arbitrary unitary transformation is you need to have a set of single qubit rotations and one type of two qubit operation, that is an entanglement operation. So with that, you can now decompose any arbitrary unit transformation into such small sets of gates. Of course, since it's unitary, you can do now the transformation from any arbitrary input state to the unitary transformed input state. This is the output state here. And since it's unitary, you can also reverse this. So it's a reversible quantum operation. So what we need to do to implement such a quantum computer is we need to prepare an initial state. We need to be able to apply these quantum operations, single qubit rotations and two qubit entanglement operations. And in the end, we will need to read out our final state. So we will need to measure in which state our system is to get an answer what was calculated. So these are different steps that we need to establish. And there's now different systems where such quantum computation is investigated. The most prominent ones are probably superconducting circuits, trapped ions and Rydberg atoms, but also photonics chips, electron spins and optical lattices are investigated, and probably many more than that. These are just examples of what is investigated. Of course, the most commercial one at the moment is probably superconducting circuits. Google and Microsoft are putting a lot of money into pushing these technologies, but also trapped ions have quite a lot of different startup companies like INQ, AQT, Oxford Ionics, and many more that are pushing to build trapped ion quantum computers and to commercialize that. So of course, there's a competition between all of these different technologies, but concerning the results that were published, trapped ions are among the best results that you can get. So why are trapped ions so good for building a quantum computer? Well, the reason for that is that all of these ions are really, really well isolated by being trapped in such an ion trap in ultra high vacuum conditions. So due to that, they stay there for a very long time. All of them are identical. All of these individual ions are exactly identical, indistinguishable. So they have the same properties also. And at the same time, you can quite well manipulate them either by laser or microwave, and by that manipulate the quantum state of these ions. Also, of course, there's different ion species where you can have different internal encoding. Here, what is plotted here is the encoding in a strontium 88 ion. What you have here as a specialty is that you have an S1/2 ground state as one of the qubit states, and the metastable D5/2 excited state as the second qubit state. This is a so-called optical qubit because you can drive this transition directly with an optical laser transition manipulate this qubit in this way. The lifetime of this metastable state here in strontium is 0.4 seconds, the natural lifetime, due to the fact that there's no low P level here over which the excited D level could decay back to an initial ground state. So basically, due to that, the transition probability is here very, very low. And due to that, it has a very, very long lifetime. If you want to measure the quantum state, you need usually a closed cycle transition in your ions to do fluorescence detection. So you excite here in the strontium 88 ions, the S1 halves ground state to the P1 halves excited state. And from there, it decays mainly back to the S1 halves ground state. So it scatters a lot of photons. And within a few milliseconds, you will know, does it fluoresce photons or does it not fluoresce photons? So for instance, you can look at a camera here and you see here the individual ions fluorescing. And if you now are in the S1 halves state, of course, all of them will fluoresce. If you are in the D5 halves excited state, the one ion that is there will not fluoresce because it doesn't see this laser resonant. It doesn't scatter photons, and due to that, it stays dark. If you want to manipulate your qubit state, you can directly send in this laser for a certain amount of time, and you will actually drive transitions between these two qubit states so that from the initial state one, it goes to state zero and back. So what happens there is, I will explain in a second. So this is basically the setup that we are usually working with. It's usually a Paul trap consisting of different electrodes here, plate electrodes plotted in this experimental schematic and two end caps. This is a Paul trap to trap the ions inside a vacuum chamber. Send laser beams onto these ions to cool them to low temperatures by laser cooling methods. And you can individually manipulate these ions by also laser manipulation, for instance, like here, this qubit manipulation on this transition. If you want to detect the ions, you can do this fluorescence detection. And then depending on in which qubit state the individual ion is, it will either fluoresce or not. And you can see it, for instance, on such a CCD camera individually for each ion, or you can look at a photomultiplier and see how many of the ions are fluorescent and how many are dark. So you can distinguish the quantum states also in this way. Of course, this is just a schematic. This is now a plate trap, a microscopic plate trap. There's also other groups that are working with microstructured traps, surface traps, and so on. And you've probably heard about that already in one of the previous talks. Okay, so this is how it looks like in reality in our experiment. So we have such a macroscopic plate trap in our experiment. The reason why we operate such a macroscopic plate trap is that we actually want the ions quite far away from our electrodes because we are working with Rydberg states in these ions. And the Rydberg states are also quite sensitive to electric field fluctuations and so on. So any surface effects that you have here on the electrodes, we wanted to avoid. That's why we built a macroscopic trap. this is all sitting in the vacuum chamber at below 10 to the minus 11 millibars. We can actually trap the ions, strontium ions, for several days, even without having on our lasers. We will still see the ions even after a weekend and switching on the lasers on Monday again. They will still be there if no one put them the lasers in such a way that they got heated out. Okay, how does such a quantum computation actually run on such a quantum computer, on a typical trapped ion quantum computer? What you will first need to do is state initialization. For instance, you want to prepare your S1 halves ground state. In principle, S1 halves is of course a Zeeman state. So if you apply a magnetic field, there will be a plus 1/2 state and a minus 1/2 state. And you can do, for instance, optical pumping to bring it in one of these two Zeeman levels. This is then your defined qubit state one. Then you can do laser cooling to bring the ions, or actually before that, you will do laser cooling to bring the ions in, for instance, emotional ground state. And by that, then make it very, very cold. You can then drive the transition from S1/2 to D5/2 to do some quantum calculations. Of course, this will be a sequence of different pulses that you apply there to different ions, different manipulations. So you need to control this qubit manipulation on each ion individually with different pulses. Or you can also apply laser pulses, of course, to all ions at the same time and do specific quantum operations with that. After that, in the end, so this is your calculation, basically. And in the end, what you will need to do, you will need to do the fluorescence detection to detect in which quantum state it was. And as I said before, if it was in the ground state, it will fluoresce. If it was in the excited state, it will not fluoresce. And due to that, depending on whether you see it fluorescent or not, you can distinguish two quantum states. If you now repeat these experiments many, many times, each time that you repeat it, you will get one outcome, either fluorescing or non-fluorescing. So in the end, what you will need to do, you will need to repeat the sequence many, many times and get statistics over it. Only then you can actually say, okay, was it maybe in a superposition of the two states, or was it always in the same qubit state? If you always get the same outcome, you know it was in this qubit state. But if you get statistics, sometimes this one, sometimes that one, you will know, okay, it probably was a superposition. But to actually say that it was really a superposition, you will actually need to also measure the phase. For that, you actually need to do some qubit rotations before to actually see in which qubit state it was. Maybe it was in going in the x-axis or in the y-axis and so on. So qubit rotations are manipulations directly on this qubit transition. You drive this laser transition directly with a laser. And if you apply now a pulse of a certain length, you will drive this transition and perform Rabi oscillations between these two states. So it will start, for instance, in the S1/2 ground state in the state one. And you apply this laser pulse for a certain amount of time, and it will start the transition to the D5/2 excited state. If you switch it on after a certain amount of time, and then just see, was it in the S or in D state? You will see, for instance, here, if you wait at this point of time, such a pulse of this length here, you will actually see 50% of the cases you get an S state as a result of the fluorescence detection, and 50% of the cases you get a D state as a result of the detection. And at this pulse length, you will see it will always end up in D state. Okay, so you get statistics. You measure that for different pulse lengths, and you see it really oscillating between these two states. Okay, so these are single qubit rotations. As said, you need single qubit rotations plus entanglement operations for any arbitrary unitary transformation to do quantum calculations. And usually what is used in trapped ion systems for performing entanglement operations is you actually use the motion of the ions as a quantum bus. So the idea behind that is that the motion of the ions is a common motion of all of the ions, for instance, the center of mass motion, is a quantum harmonic oscillator. It oscillates like you see here, and you can actually drive the quantum harmonic oscillator in such a way that you can also manipulate the quantum state of this quantum harmonic oscillator. So for instance, what you can do is you can initially cool it to the ground state, and then with dedicated laser pulses manipulate this quantum of motion. So what basically happens is that your absorbing photon from this laser pulse will give the ion a momentum kick, and momentum kick of the photon will then bring the whole ion string in oscillation. Okay. So it's that all of the ions see this motion at the same time. And since all of these ions see the motion at the same time, depending on what you had initially manipulated, they actually share this information of the harmonic oscillator motion. So here's a little bit of a schematic of that. You have, for instance, here calcium or strontium ion, doesn't really matter. You have here the transition from the S1 half state or D5 half state that I described before. So it can also be strontium 88, just with a different wavelength. And on top of that, you have the motion of the ion string, of the whole ions together as a harmonic oscillator. So these are the degrees of freedom that you have, the quantum degrees of freedom of your system. And now what you can do is you can drive this transition on an optical qubit in such a way that you drive directly this transition. Here you see the spectroscopy of this transition. You see here the carrier transition that you drive this S to D transition directly, but you can also drive sidebands, motional sidebands. And these motional sidebands mean there you actually transfer the momentum kick of this absorbed or emitted photon. And by that, you actually manipulate at the same time the quantum motion. So here is the common the 2 degrees of freedom SD and the harmonic oscillator motion actually split up. You can either be, for instance, an SN0, SN1, SN2, SN3. So this is SN0, 1, 2, and 3, and so on. You can also be in a D state and 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. These are these levels up here. So these are the energy of the common quantum state. And if you now drive transitions, you can either drive here the carrier transition, which only changes the quantum state of the ion itself, the electronic state, but you can also drive sideband transition. And these sidebands transition can be either now a blue sideband or a red sideband. The blue sideband will now, depending on which state you start, for instance, if you start in S state, you will add one quantum of motion. The red sideband will, from the S state, subtract one quantum of motion and flip it to the D state each. Okay. So these are motional manipulation of your quantum state. The usual or standard way of driving now motional entanglement operations in such quantum computers is, for instance, for optical qubits, such Mermer-Sorensen entanglement operations. So Mermer-Sorensen entanglement operations, what you do here is you drive actually at the same time the red sideband and the blue sideband, both of them slightly detuned. So here, the red sideband, for instance, if you start now with two ions in S or two ions in D or two ions in DS and SD. So now here are the motional quantum states, depending on that. You, for instance, can start in SS, an n quantum of motion. And now the red sideband would take out one quantum of motion and flip one of these two ions. So from SS, n, it would go to SD, n minus one, or to DS, n minus one. And now a blue sideband could flip the other ion of these two and put the quantum of motion back in. So you would end up from SSN in DDN again. Of course, there's different options also. You could also go from SSN to DDN via first a blue sideband and then a red sideband. So first put one quantum of motion in and flip one ion and take one quantum of motion out and flip the second ion. So there's different options. And this is basically an interferometer. There's different paths and all of them interfere with each other. Okay. So summing all of these paths here, what you actually get is that the transition probability from SSN to DDN is actually independent on the motional quantum state N. This is the advantage of this Mermer-Sorensen entanglement operation. That's why you actually don't need to cool this to very, very low temperatures. You don't need to cool it to the motional ground state necessarily. But what it does, the Mermer-Sorensen operation, is that it does drives transition from SS to DD after a certain amount of time. And if you do it in the right way, then actually you get correlated spin flips SS to DD, and you can drive, for instance, from SS to an entangled state SS plus DDD. So for two ions, of course, it's entangled state 1 over square root of 2 SS plus DD. For more ions, for instance, here for four ions, you get a much more complicated path that different ions can flip and add or subtract quantum of motions, but still you get an effective coupling between SSSS and DDDD. Okay. So what you will end up with after a certain amount of time controlling this interaction is a GZ state of this type. This has been demonstrated quite a long time ago, actually in 2011, for up to 14 ions. And what you then can generate, don't want to go into detail what is actually plotted here, the parity signal, but what is actually the characteristic here is the amplitude of these parity oscillation signal tells you something about the fidelity. So how coherent the system is after this operation. So how much the phase relation between these two states is actually still there. And with a bit larger than 50%, you can actually say that here you really have a 14 qubit entangled state, if it's a little bit above 50%. So this was in 2011, up to 14 ions. Actually, just recently this paper, the Innsbruck group extended this to up to 24 ions. So it's a new record for tripped ions. Okay, so what is actually important here to mention, such operations for Engelmann operations usually take quite a bit of time. So in this case here, you need actually something like 50 microseconds to do such an operation. If you combine this with individual qubit rotations, you can get a full set of quantum operations in such a system. So this is now, you can apply arbitrary calculations, arbitrary unitary transformations. For instance, what you can do is you can do Shor's factorization of number 15. This has been demonstrated in 2016. That's just an example. So you apply different of these operations on different ions. And in the end, you measure what is the result. And depending on what the result is, you can actually say, okay, 15 is 5 times 3. Of course, this is just a basic demonstration that you can actually do such calculations. If you really want to do something useful, you have to scale this to many, many ions and make this as fast as possible. Okay, so you want to get a quantum computer that is really, really useful. And for that, you have to do scale it to many, many qubits. But at the same time, you have to actually make gate operations that are really, really low, with low error. So what has been demonstrated so far in trapped ions, based on this technology, either with laser manipulation or with microwave manipulation, is individual rotations of up to 70 ion qubits, as far as I know, 24 ion entanglement, as I said, showed you already a few slides ago, quantum simulations with more than 50 ions, and all of the gate errors have been demonstrated with lower error than 10 to the minus 3. The 10 to minus 3 is actually quite important, because if you are below 10 to minus 3, in principle, you can do quantum error correction. And quantum error correction is important because you will always have errors on your operations. And if you have too many errors, your outcome will be wrong. So only if you apply quantum error correction, you will be able to get the correct result if your calculation is very, very complex. So you will need this quantum error correction. For that, you need all of these gate errors below 10 to the minus 3. But as I said, the drawback of trapped ion systems is a bit that for the standard entanglement gates that I showed you before, the gates are rather slow, on the order of 50 microseconds per gate. And it's not so easy to do these entanglement operations in large ion crystals. So as I said, the 24 ion entanglement operation, that's a record. But can you do entanglement operations in a 1,000 ion crystal? That's of course the question. And what people usually do is they split up ion crystals in smaller ion strings, or actually link the different ion strings in different traps via photonic interconnects to get more complex systems. So these are two technologies that are currently being developed for getting to larger ion crystals and entanglement operations in that. On the other hand side, there's also some effort to make these entanglement operations faster. But what you will then need to do is you need to control not only one motional mode, but you need to control many motional modes at the same time, because each of these ions actually vibrates in three directions, X, Y, and Z. So you have three N, if you have N ions, three N motional modes. And all of them have share a certain frequency spectrum. And if you want to manipulate now the motional modes and you want to make it fast, then your pulses have to be short. And which means the pulses will be so short that you will manipulate all of these motion modes at the same time, because it covers actually broad spectrum due to Fourier transform of this short pulse. Which means if you then need to control all of these motional modes, it gets quite complicated, which also makes the entanglement operations actually complicated again. So this has been demonstrated, fast gates have been demonstrated for 2 ions, but not so much for 20 ions. That's also a complication here. Okay, so on the other hand side, there's also a different technology, the Rydberg atoms. And the Rydberg atoms are based on a completely different type of entanglement operation. So here, what you have, for instance, here is such a individual atoms trapped at individual sites by dipole lasers. And the distance between them is on the order of 5 to 10 micrometer. And now if you have neighboring ions, they can actually talk to each other. They can exchange information between each other by the so-called Rydberg interaction. So that also many, many similar things have been demonstrated. Also 20 ion atom GZ states, quantum simulations with up to 200 atoms, and even parallel gates. So you can perform a gate here and there at the same time, for instance. So that's something nice that makes things a little bit less complicated than these many, many motional modes in trapped ions. On the other hand side, what is the advantage of Rydberg atoms is that they can trap them in 2D and 3D atomic arrays. And that's, of course, something nice for making this coupling actually very, very complicated in 2 and 3D. You can couple these ones and these ones at the same time. So it's a nice topology where you can do complex calculations at the same time. Okay, so what are we doing? We are looking into trapped Rydberg ions, and the idea behind that is actually to combine the trapped ion system. So a really, really nice long trapping of atoms in charged atoms. We don't need to load them and throw them out again, load them and throw them out again. So this is a nice system to operate for a long time. And we want to operate at the same time Rydberg interaction. The idea was published in 2008 by the group of Peter Zöller. Markus Miller and Igor Lesanowski are both professors now somewhere in Germany in theory. And they proposed that in 2008. Since then, there's two groups actually working on that, one in Mainz and we in Stockholm. So Ferdinand Schmidt-Kahle is actually working on that. And he was actually the first one to realize trapped Rydberg ions. Okay, why is it so interesting to do Rydberg physics? So of course, if you do Rydberg, if you excite an ion or atom into Rydberg state, it will be one of the electrons will be in an orbital, will be very far outside. So it's really on a not macroscopic, but on a large orbital around the core. Due to the size of these Rydberg atoms or ions, you get actually a radius that is Bohr radius times n to the power of 2, where n is the principal quantum number of this Rydberg orbital. And if you now compare, for instance, an strontium ion in the ground state, which has a diameter of below nanometers, and a strontium ion in the 30S state, so principal quantum number 30, you see that it's already 100 times bigger in radius or diameter. And of course, the volume is 100 cube. Okay, so it's really, really huge compared to such a small strontium ground state ion. On the same time, also the lifetime of these Rydberg levels is really, really long, because since the overlap between the electronic wave function of the Rydberg electron and the inner shells is very, very small, the transition probability is actually getting small. And due to that, the lifetime very long. So it scales actually with the principal quantum number n as a power of 3. And since it's quite big, it's also quite easy to polarize it. So the polarizability of such a Rydberg atom or ion actually scales as a principal quantum number n to the power of 7. So that makes very, very special properties. And of course, also due to that, for instance, if you have a dipole-dipole interaction, the van der Waals interaction, of course, it relies on the induced dipoles, which is, of course, related to the polarizability. So you can get really, really strong van der Waals interaction, for instance. And if you have a strong van der Waals interaction, if you have now two atoms or ions next to each other, then you get an interaction, the van der Waals interaction. So if both of them are in the Rydberg state. Here is plotted the atomic separation versus these energy levels. So of course, ground-ground state, there's no interaction between them. So there's no shift of the of this energy level with the distance. In the ground Rydberg state, if only one of them is in a Rydberg state, also there's no strong, no really relevant interaction. Only if you bring both of them into Rydberg state, there's the interaction, Tuitive van der Waals interaction. And if you now want to excite an atom or both of these atoms into Rydberg state, if you are, for instance, here at a distance of typically around 10 micrometers, you can excite one of these atoms into Rydberg state. But if you want to excite a second one into Rydberg state with the same laser, then your Tuitive van der Waals interaction shifted out of resonance. So you cannot excite the second atom anymore into Rydberg state because it's just not resonant anymore. Okay, so this is the so-called Rydberg blockade effect due to this van der Waals interaction that you cannot excite a second atom next to a first Rydberg atom. Of course, if you now put ions into the Rydberg state, then you have to ask, okay, you have strong electric fields in your ion trap. So the strong electric fields might affect your Rydberg ion and might affect it in such a way that maybe it doesn't really work anymore. Maybe the electron is just ripped off, okay? But if you look a little bit closer, then the position where an ion is trapped in our pole trap is actually at the center of this quadrupole field. And the center of the quadrupole field is actually a position where the electric field is zero. So here at the settle point of this quadrupole potential, you have a zero electric field. And due to that, the Rydberg atom or ion here in the center actually doesn't see such a big electric field. Of course, once it moves a little bit outside, it will see the electric field and is affected by that. And I will also probably quickly talk a bit about that in a second. On the other hand side, how big is such a Rydberg ion? It's on the order of 100 nanometers, let's say. So which means it's much bigger than a ground state ion. It's much bigger than what ion would actually move in our trap. It's on the order of 30 nanometers, but it's still smaller than the ion distance. So each of these Rydberg ions is an individual Rydberg ion. So there's no electron that would overlap between different ions or something like that. So each of them is an individual Rydberg ion, and there would be an individual Rydberg ion there or individual Rydberg ion there. So we can individually manipulate them by laser pulses. If you want to excite an ion into Rydberg state, you need quite a lot of energy. So for instance, here are different typical ion species from barium, strontium, calcium, and so on. And you see here the energy that you need for exciting it into Rydberg state is quite high, which means if you want to excite it with a single laser pulse with a single laser transition, you need very, very short wavelengths, typically in the vacuum UV. And of course, it is very complicated to operate. But still, Mainz in 2015 actually demonstrated that it's possible to generate light that is resonant to this transition to Rydberg state and excite ions into Rydberg state. So this was published by Thomas Felker was first author in there. We initially already decided we cannot set up such an experiment. We don't have such a laser standing around. And due to that, it was more complicated to set it up for us. But our idea was, well, then let's use two lasers, both of them in a regime where it's not vacuum UV, it's UV light, of course, 243 nanometers and 305 nanometers. But we can actually drive this via an intermediate level into Rydberg state by these two lasers. And that's what we actually do. So we excite from the initial D5 half level, so the metastable qubit state, to the Rydberg state with these two photon transition. And from there, it will decay mainly back to the S1 half strand state if we don't bring it back down intentionally. So if we just wait for it to decay, which means if we just want to do spectroscopy of these two lasers, we can just excite it to Rydberg state and wait. And if we then detect that we see this population transfer to the S1 half ground state, we know we have excited to Rydberg state. So if it fluoresces, we know the population transfer has happened. If it, on the other hand side, stays dark, we know we didn't excite it. So this is the way that we do spectroscopy. And we can do that now, for instance, first with the first laser. the first step of this root back excitation, and we excite it first into the immediate level. Also from there, it decays mainly back to the ground state. We can detect the fluorescence detection, and we see a signal of this population transfer from D5 halves to S1 halves. We see the resonance of this transition. If we then shine in the coupling laser, or coupling these two lasers from the excited state to root back state at the same time, we see that we can couple these two levels quite strongly. We actually see an auto-town splitting, which means we get trace states of the excited state and the root back state. So it's a superposition of these two. And these trace states we can now probe with a lower level transition. So we detune this laser here across the resonance. And if we now hit the first trace level, we see one resonance. If we see the second trace level, we see the other trace level here. So we know we strongly couple these upper two levels and we get trace states up there. We can use that now also for coherent root back excitation. So by coupling, controlling the amplitudes of these lasers individually. So the lower probe laser will couple the initial state to the intermediate state, to the excited state, via the Rabi frequency omega p. And the coupling laser up here will couple the excited state to root back state via the Rabi frequency omega c. So this is the three-level Hamiltonian. If you're in resonance, then there's no detuning here standing on a diagonal. That's then the coupling Hamiltonian of these three levels with these two lasers. One of the eigenstates of this three-level Hamiltonian is so-called dark state, which means it only consists of the initial state zero and the root back state r. And the relative amplitude of these two states is defined by the relative amplitude of these two Rabi frequencies. So for instance, if you switch off your pump laser initially, the Rabi frequency of this omega p is zero, and then your initial state is actually equal to the dark state. If you then slowly ramp up the omega p, so if you slowly then switch on your probe laser while the coupling laser is quite strong, then you get an adiabatic transfer within this dark state. So if you follow this dark eigenstate, you from the initial state zero, now you slowly map the population to the root back state r, because the dark eigenstate rotates and the system just follows this dark eigenstate. So by switching off omega c now, you will get no population anymore in the zero state, and all the population will be in the root back state. So when you follow these dark eigenstates, the nice thing is actually that you almost basically never populate intermediate state. And all the population is transferred from zero to the root back state without a population populating actually the intermediate state. And the intermediate state we don't want to populate because it decays very, very fast. That's why I call it dark. Of course, it's not perfectly dark. Also, the root back state decays to some extent. So there's a little bit of gray eigenstate, I would say, because this state actually also decays. Okay. If you now do this population transfer from the initial state to root back state, of course, you just map the population from here to there and it will decay. So this is the yellow point that you see here. We don't have any almost no population anymore in the initial state. And basically all of the population is transferred to the other state. Of course, we don't know, did it go via the intermediate state or did it really go via the root back state? And for that to test, we actually needed to map the population first to root back state, wait for some time and map it back to the initial state. So if there was the ion still resided in the root back state, we know after some time, we can only map the population that was in the root back state back to the initial state. And if we do that, we can actually measure the lifetime of our root back state. So we can transfer population back to initial state. We measure the lifetime, and the lifetime is actually more or less consistent to the theory at room temperature conditions. So we have blackbody radiation actually that limits this lifetime. Okay, the efficiency we can also calculate from going up and down. So the very short stirrup sequence, we actually got something like 80% efficiency. So a single stirrup transfer was a bit bigger than 90%. Of course, this is limited by our laser intensities and the laser frequency stabilities. In the meantime, we get it quite significantly higher. Okay, I said the Rydberg ion is also quite sensitive to electric field. The parasitability scales as n to the power of 7, so principal quantum number n to the power of 7. Since the RID trapped ion has also a non-zero spatial extent, so the motional state here is also reaching areas where there's an electric field. Of course, due to that, also the ion here actually sees some areas where the electric field is oscillating. And since the electric field is actually increasing here from the center linearly, if you now look at the Stark effect due to this polarizability of the Rydberg ion, the additional energy that is shifted due to this Stark effect is minus 1/2 rho, the polarizability times the average electric field squared, or electric field squared averaged. Since the electric field, as I said, scales linearly with a distance to the center, you actually get something that is an harmonic potential, an additional harmonic potential, additional to the normal trapping potential that you have. And you can see that, for instance, by looking at different transitions now from the ground state, from the metastable state to Rydberg state. So you have a potential here in the grounds in the metastable state. There's no polarizability almost. So this is the trapping potential of the electron. And then in the Rydberg state, due to this polarizability, you have actually this additional trapping potential, which adds now or subtracts with respect to the trapping potential that you have usually from the trapping in the pole trap. And due to that, this trapping potential is slightly different than the one in the D5 mass level. And since it's slightly different, also the difference between the energy levels is slightly different. And which means depending on in which motional state you start, you actually get a different transition energy going to Rydberg state. So this is one of the fact that you have, for instance, going from the Rydberg polarizability. So depending on the quantum state, motional quantum state, you have energy state, one transition, slightly different transition, slightly different transition. And now you can actually measure these different energy transitions, these different transition energies, and you see this resonance shift. So for instance, for different motional phonon states, for different motional quantum numbers here, you get this energy resonance shift, and this is actually consistent with the polarizability that you would expect for a Rydberg state. So it's not so simple as you would expect, and especially if you now don't go start, for instance, in the motional ground state, but if you start in the thermal state here, what you will actually have is a distribution of different levels here, different populations here, and due to that, actually a broadening of your resonance line. So motional sideband cooled in the motional ground state, transition will look differently than if you have just a Doppler cooled ion with n equal to 10 or 20 or something like that on average. Okay, this is of course a little bit complicated if you want to do coherent operation, because the line width here also means the line width limits your coherence. Okay, and the line width basically defines your coherence. Depending on where you start, you have a different phase evolution. Due to that, if you now drive transitions from the initial state to Rydberg state, and if you want to drive that coherently, for instance, driving Rabi oscillations, you see that this coherent driving of these transitions is now damped out because of this broadening of the line. So for a Doppler cooled, a sideband cooled ion, for an ion in a ground state, you see Rabi oscillations, while for an ion in a motional state, unfortunately, you don't see Rabi oscillations anymore. This makes it a little bit complicated to operate. So what we need to do in such an ion trap is you need to drive it to motional ground state. There's an alternative. You can also tune the polarizability of your Rydberg state by mixing different Rydberg levels. One is positive polarizability and one is negative polarizability. And that's something that we actually do for the next part that I explain now. So if you now want to use this Rydberg-Rydberg interaction for quantum gates. So that's our main goal. We want to do quantum calculation in our Rydberg ions. And as I said, usually with Rydberg atoms, people use the van der Waals interaction. Van der Waals interaction is an induced dipole-dipole interaction. So a second order effect basically of your interaction Hamiltonian, which means the interaction scales as the distance to the power of -6, but at the same time, it actually scales as the effective core charge to the power of minus six. And the effective core charge for strontium ion, basically you have the outermost electron and a doubly charged core. That for the effective core charge in this system is Z equal to 2. And this is, of course, double compared to a neutral Rydberg atom experiment. And due to that, this is 2 to the power of 6 times smaller than in neutral Rydberg atom experiments. The reason for that is just the electron is more tightly bound to the core. And due to that, the effective effects of the Rydberg states are smaller. The Coulomb interaction between electron and core is, of course, bigger. Okay, so this doesn't really work for our system. We could get an interaction of something like only 20 kilohertz compared to the lifetime of Rydberg states. This is just too slow. So we have to get faster. And this was already proposed by the Zoller group. So what they proposed is that they actually induce real dipoles in Rydberg states. And for inducing real dipoles, you apply an external electric field. So if you now apply an external electric field that moves the electron wave function away from the core, you get here a real dipole, and then you would get dipole-dipole interaction. If you then calculate the interaction strength of such a dipole-dipole interaction between Rydberg ions, you get to an interaction strength on the order of a few megahertz, which is actually strong enough compared to the lifetime. So this is something that can work out. What we actually do is we drive microwave transitions between Rydberg state to induce these oscillating, these dipoles. So what happens is we have, for instance, a 46S one half state and a 46P one half state. We drive this transition with a microwave. And by that, we get dressed states. And dressed states is now a superposition of S state plus P state. Of course, if you look into a non-rotating frame of these dressed states, you get actually an S plus e to the I omega t, where omega is the frequency of the microwave, p orbital. So this is a state that is a superposition of s and p with rotating phase, which means at some point you will have a plus, plus, plus here, which means they will add up on top and subtract on the bottom. At some other time, they will subtract on the bottom, top, and add up on the bottom. So basically the wave function of such a dress state is actually a wave function that oscillates around the core. So it's like here plotted, the electron actually moves up and down and up and down and relative to the core. So you have an oscillating dipole that is oscillating around. If you have two of these ions next to each other, you get a dipole-dipole interaction between these oscillating dipoles, which means since you apply a microwave, of course, these oscillating dipoles will oscillate in phase to each other. Due to that, the oscillating interaction will be maximal, basically. Okay, so what we do is we excite into Rydberg state with the microwave on all the time. The dipole-dipoles interact with each other due to this, the oscillating dipoles interact with each other due to the rotating dipoles. And we now can see these dress states first. We can probe these dress states by looking at our Rydberg states. So we drive this transition. We get coupling between S and P. And now you get dress states of these S and P. And you can probe that now with probing the from the initial D state to Rydberg state, where do you see a resonance? So here you see a plus level of S plus P and a minus level of S minus P. So these are the two dress levels that you would expect when changing the tuning of your microwave field. Of course, we want to actually look into Rydberg interaction. So we want to see some kind of blockade effect like the neutral Rydberg atom people look at. And what we do there is now we drive our transitions from the initial state to Rydberg state when they're coupled with this microwave, either without microwave or with microwave, and compare the two. Without microwave, we said there should almost be no interaction. Van der Waals interaction is too weak. So we can actually drive our transition from the initial state to Rydberg state. And since there's almost no interaction, this transition here and this transition there for the first or the second ion being excited to Rydberg state are almost indistinguishable. So you can excite a first ion to Rydberg state, but you can also excite a second ion to Rydberg state because it's independent from each other. There's no interaction. And you can see that in the so-called Rabi oscillations, the green line is the Rabi oscillation of a single ion, and the blue and the red line are Rabi oscillations of two ions next to each other that are not interacting with each other. The DD the red is actually both ions going from DD to a Rydberg state, to red Rydberg. So we actually see both of them going to the other state, to the S1-Hausdorff ground state. And we see here that this is actually the square of the green line. So if you have a probability for one ion going to Rydberg state, then the probability for both of these ions going to Rydberg state is, of course, the probability squared. So the green line squared should be the red one. And it actually follows quite well this relation. Of course, one of them only going to Rydberg state is then probability times one minus probability times two. So this is the blue line. And it also follows more or less. If you now go to a microwave dressed Rydberg level, what happens is, of course, you have Rydberg interaction to this dipole, through this dipole-dipole interaction. And if you do that, then one of these ions can get excited to Rydberg states, but the second one not anymore because it shifted out of resonance. And you see a clear difference now. The green line is again a single ion being excited to Rydberg state, and the red line would be both of these ions next to each other that are interaction acting, being excited to Rydberg state. And you see it's almost not happening anymore, only slowly increasing here. So we are blocking actually the excitation of a second ion at Rydberg state, and we see this Rydberg blockade effect. Okay, if you want to do now a gate from that, you need to go a step further. You need to excite both of these ions now into Rydberg state, and you need to look for interaction between these two. So this is the pulse sequence that we apply. It's similar to the stirrup pulse sequence that I showed you before. And we excite actually both of these ions into Rydberg state, not Rydberg blockaded. We drive in such a way that both of them get excited. If you only excite, if you start from different initial states, one of them gets excited to Rydberg state, the zero state, while the one state doesn't get excited to Rydberg state. This one gets both excited to Rydberg state. Since there's an interaction, the interaction actually shifts this energy level. While if only one ion gets excited to the Rydberg state, there's no interaction, no energy level shift, so no shift. And if, of course, none of these ions gets excited to Rydberg state because it's there in the other qubit state, there's no energy level shift at all. So due to the energy level shift, you will actually get after some time a phase accumulated. Energy level shift times time accumulates a phase. So if you go with both ions being excited to Rydberg state, you will accumulate due to this energy level shift minus Rydberg phase. And this is actually a controlled phase gate. We test this controlled phase gate by, for instance, starting in a full mixture of these ions in 0 plus 1. And depending on whether both of them were in 0, 0, this one gets a phase. So due to that, detecting one of these ions in the Rydberg state, it either gets a phase in the state 0 after this applying this gate. One of them, if it was 0, this one actually experienced a phase shift. While if it was in one, this one doesn't experience a phase shift. And so we can actually distinguish when it gets a phase shift and when it doesn't get a phase shift. We can also measure the entangled state and characterize the entangled state. And we can characterize that measuring the fidelity of this entangled state that we generate by this phase gate is something like 78%. Note that the whole stirrup up and stirrup down sequence actually takes only 700 nanoseconds, so it's faster than a microsecond compared to the 50 microseconds that a typical trapped ion gate takes. This is very, very fast. Errors that we have are quite big. As I said, 78% fidelity only, but we know that most of them are technical errors and that we actually can suppress them quite well. So we should actually be able to suppress the errors to significantly below 1% error if we get better stability of our microwave and lasers, higher laser power and smaller ion distance. Okay, how does it compare to different trapped ion gates? I said it's quite fast. These are typical gate operations that we would usually use. This is one gate operation, also via motional operation of two ions, that was even a little bit faster than ours, but also their fidelity was not perfect. And this is due to the fact that it's actually smaller than one oscillation period of the ions in time, or on the order for oscillation period in time. So it's actually reaching the limit of motional gates. On the other hand side, if we put our ions closer together, the interaction should get faster. And due to that, we should still be able to reach faster entanglement operations. So we still have some room to improve. And by that, we also think we can improve the fidelity at the same time. If you put more ions into the string, I think my time is almost up. I'll try to reach an end. If you put more ions into the string, actually the outer ions push the inner ions together due to Coulomb repulsion. And due to that, the inner ions have a much, much smaller distance. So you can reach distances that are significantly smaller in longer ion strings. And since the interaction scales as the Rydberg interaction scales as 1/3, it actually gets faster and faster the closer they are together. So in principle, we can speed up our operations in longer ion strings. We have tried this in a 12-ion string. And we see that we can still perform the same gate operation between two ions in the center of such a longer ion string. And unfortunately, the fidelity dropped even a little bit further. This is due to the motion along the longitudinal axis mostly. And we know that it's a technical problem and that we can actually improve that by actually exciting from radial direction. So with that, we should be able to get much better fidelity still. In principle, this should also work in 2D and 3D crystals. Of course, we haven't shown that yet, but this is actually an option how to scale this to a larger number of ion qubits. So it should work in longer ion crystals. It should probably even work in 2D or 3D ion crystals. And that's something that we of course want to show. To summarize, what I've showed you is that we have developed the technology together with the Mainz group to combine trapped ions and Rydberg atom technology. Of course, there's a lot of new physics to be investigated in this novel quantum system. And we have managed to demonstrate a sub-microsecond two ion gate in the system. So this is a first step towards really using that for some quantum operations, quantum calculations. Of course, what we need to do to really use it is we need to market higher fidelity, certainly. We need to show that we can do that really in a scalable way in bigger ion crystals, and that we can continue to do it as fast as we do it now. Of course, there's also different options that you can use the system for, like quantum simulations or for connecting it to other quantum system, but I don't really want to go into detail in that. With that, I would like to thank all the people that contributed to that, mainly Fabian and Jared, who were the three PhD students working on the Rydberg ion experiment for several years. They are now all three finished. She is at Imperial College, Fabian at Oxford, and Jared and Thomas at the moment. And of course, so these are the three people that had the main contribution to these entanglement operations. On top of that, I would also like to thank our theory collaboration in collaborators, Igor and Vibin, who did a great job in for us understanding the system. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer questions.